And welcome to Grand Rounds. This is today's CME code, Foktun. Come on in, folks, we've started.
Come on.
Is this the stroke team?
No.
What team is this team?
It's like three
coffees. Coffee and food for everybody. Foktun. Today is International Women's Day, started in 1911. Which was interesting. That was before they even had the right to vote. March 8th is also the first day of the Festival of Hollies, which is a very important Hindu holiday. So congratulations to everybody. This is a big deal. Yeah, that Chris Eckstein is stepping down from his role as residency director, not due to any scandal or anything, but he's just done his time and is handing it off to Suma Shah. He's just done a remarkable job, and he's gonna stay on as the associate residency director. And I owe Chris a dinner, so you know, we'll arrange that soon. What day does that happen, Chris?
April 1st,
April Fool's Day. There you go. Okay, I didn't even read this last night, but there's an epic software upgrade coming, and it's a big one, so hold your hats. our all-stars is Laura Wadi. Suma Shah nominated her for her usual excellent approach and hard work on the inpatient consult service. Congratulations, Laura, and your coffee cup is coming. Also, Mandy Stone, I think this is her second all-star award, nominated by Lindsay Anthony for handling a very tough situation in the clinic. So congratulations. You're going to have a cup for your son too now. Oh, and Joel is an all-star nominated by an anonymous patient who talked about the exceptional care he received from Joel, also complimented the ED staff. But I mean, for Joel, this is just standard, excellent is standard. It's just that this anonymous patient happened to notice. But congratulations, Joel. Do you have a coffee cup yet? We'll get one for your son. I don't have a coffee cup. Research roundup, Ann Augustine wrote an article discussing non-REM parasomnias. I was just listening to a podcast about a guy who killed his mother while sleepwalking, murdered her, and got off. So there you go. And Andrew Spector and Maggie Soltis wrote a review of polysomnography and obstructive sleep apnea. I still don't know what those reports say. I just look to see if they say they need CPAP or not. So we were with the residents on Tuesday. For 5 years, I've been trying to stop saying you guys, and it's not easy. And I think as a group, we should all try to do it. I mean, there's nothing wrong with it, but they're not all guys. And it'd be better to say other things. For you from the South, you can say y'all, hey folks, okay everyone, okay people, hey team. There are lots of alternatives, and there's the New Jersey version, use guys. See if you can change, stop saying that. It's surprisingly difficult. The only time you know you've said it is after you've said it. If speech was like we thought it is, where you think about what you're saying, you'd know you were saying it before you said it, but you just don't. It's only when it comes out, you say, I didn't want to say that. Which teaches us a lot about you guys and about speech. So again, this is today's CME code, Foktun. And now doing our case, virtually is Ton Wannarong, who is a neuromuscular fellow. So Ton, take it away. I'll stop share. There you go.
Thank you very much, Dr. O'Brien. Let me share my screen.
Oh, look at that. Are you in Hawaii? I knew he wasn't in Hawaii. All right, we see it beautifully.
All right. Okay. Good morning, everyone. My name is Ton Wannarong. I'm one of the neuromuscular medicine fellows, and I'm very happy to present a case that I saw with Dr. Jewel in the clinic. All right, let's start. I have an 82-year-old man who presented with the abnormal muscle contraction. He described it for several years. And he said that most of the movement are in the proximal arms. And he described it as a painless rolling and twitching of the muscle. And it can be aggravated by squeezing or stretching of that area. Here is the video of the muscle movement that he described. So this is the deltoid. So when we try to squeeze it, you can see a delay contraction and relaxation of the muscle. You might think that it's not quite clear. I have the video of another patient that I got it from the AAN website. This one might be a little bit more clear. You can see the wave-like movement of the muscle, and it's happened when the patient tried to stretch the quadricep, or it's happened even when he tried to like tap the muscle like this. However, those presentation, we describe it as a rippling muscle, but the rippling muscle is very, very rare. There are several neuromuscular disorders that might mimic this presentation, such as fasciculation in motor neuron disease or myokymia in radiation in duplexopathy. So to make you better understand the difference between this condition, I have the video of myokymia that I would like to show you. And this one is, again, I got it from the AAN website. You can see like a scatter contraction of the muscle. And this might sometimes look very similar to the rippling muscle due to the continuous movement. And the very sometimes very difficult to differentiate. But with the EMG, we can differentiate these two conditions very easily. Here is the EMG of the... Here is the EMG of the myokymia. You can see this classic sound of the marching sound. Why the rippling muscle, when you put the EMG in, I don't have the video of our patient, but when you put the needle in the rippling muscle, you will hear nothing, which we call electrically silent.
Ton, can you repeat that? Your video's gotten quite soft.
Oh, let me...
Your audio, I meant. We can't hear you.
Oh, okay. So what I want to say is between the myokymia and the rippling muscle, sometimes it's difficult to differentiate it clinically. But with the EMG, it's very easy to differentiate between these two conditions. The myokymia, you can see the marching or hear the marching sound. It's very classic. But with the rippling muscle, you will hear nothing, which we call electrically silent. The reason behind is because the pathomechanism of these two conditions are different. Myokymia is caused by the nerve disease and is sending the abnormal electrical activity to the muscle fiber. So you can record the electrical activity from the muscle that you examine. But the rippling muscle, there is no clear mechanism, but one of the theory that I feel that is make the most sense is it's explained by the local problem inside the muscle cell. They explain that the stretch gonna induce the mechanosensitive calcium release in the sarcoplasmic reticulum. And that calcium spread to the tubular system inside the muscle cell. That's why you cannot detect any abnormality from the sarcomere or the cell membrane. Another condition I would like to show you is myoedema. This one is seen in very unique situations such as hypothyroidism. You can see the molding of the muscle and really relaxation. And again, if you put the needle in inside this muscle, you will hear nothing. We call it electrically silent as well. And the explanation is due to the calcium interaction with the inside the muscle cell. Back to our patient, we did the EMG and nerve conduction study. And obviously it was normal. We put the needle inside the muscle that has a rippling movement and we hear nothing, we call it electrically silent. We check the CK and it's normal for his body mass. Given the clinical presentation, nerve conduction study and EMG, this patient was diagnosed with rippling muscle disease. It is a muscular hyperexcitability disorder, which is characterized by spontaneous or mechanical tickering, electrically silent rippling muscle movements. The presentation can range from painless rippling muscles to severe muscle stiffness and myalgia. Weakness is very uncommon. There are two forms of rippling muscle disease. One is a hereditary form, and the other one is a sporadic form. For the hereditary form, there are two genes that you might find that is associated with. The first one is caveolin-3, and the second one is caveolin-1. We checked that genetic testing, and it was negative. So the second form is a sporadic form. The sporadic form can be associated with autoimmune disorder or sometimes with the cancer. So we did check the malignancy screening in this patient, and he did not have any malignancy. So we thought that is this condition that he has most likely immune mediated. And from the previous study, we found that the acetylcholine receptor antibody is found to be positive in the majority of the case. And those patients may or may not have clinical myasthenia gravis. So we checked the acetylcholine receptor in this patient and it was positive. And during that time, he did not have any clinical myasthenia gravis. Mayo group just published the paper that they found the antibody called caveolin-4, and they thought it is probably the potential marker in the immune-mediated rippling muscle disease. So further research needs to be conducted. So back to our patient, as I mentioned, that he has an acetylcholine receptor antibody, and then 6 months later, he developed the clinical myasthenia gravis, which described as a diplopia and my eyelid closure weakness. We confirmed with the repetitive nerve stimulation and single fiber EMG, and they were abnormal. So he was diagnosed with superimposed seropositive ocular myasthenia gravis. And we treat him with the prednisone initially, and he did not respond. So we switched to mycophenolate mofetil. The MG was responsive very well. He went into complete remission, but the rippling muscle still persists. And actually, most of the patients in our cohort did not respond well with the immunosuppressive medication. Only one patient seemed to respond very well with the IVIG. And also the patient developed the pain later and he did not respond well with the pain medication as well. Take home message for this case is the presentation that is very classic wave-like movement that you can see from the video. And if the genetic testing is negative, you have to think of the sporadic form and you have to screen for the malignancy and autoimmune disorder. So here is the presentation.
Thank you very much, Tom. That was great. Okay. Now I have to share screen. Minimize this. Okay. So today's grand round speaker is Dr. Tim Collins. We all know Tim, professor of neurology, and he's our division chief for headache and pain. And he's also the medical director of the Maureen Road Clinic in the Department of Neurology. He's built an incredibly successful headache program at Duke. And he's going to talk to us today about update on opioid therapy. This also helps qualify for your required CMEs to continue to prescribe controlled substances. So Tim, thanks for agreeing to do it, and I'll turn it over to you. Let me just minimize, put your slides up. Okay, it's all yours.
Thanks, Rich. Hopefully everyone can see the screen here. We're gonna be talking about opioid therapy and a little bit of updates on this in general. So one question here is why do we talk about this? So the most recent data that we have from the CDC regarding opioid deaths is that in 2021, there were 142,000 roughly overdose deaths, and 84,000 of those were opioid related, and only about 13,000 of them were prescription opioids. The number of deaths from opioid overdose has been progressively increasing over the years. From 2019 to 2020, the number of opioid overdose deaths went up by 30%. But from 2020 to 2021, it only increased by 15%. But that's still disturbing, despite all the efforts that we're making to limit diversion of opioids from prescription opioids to the illicit market and the attempts at blocking the importation of all the synthetic fentanyl. We're still seeing a progressive increase in opioid overdoses. So,
Are the number of prescribed opioid deaths, we know that number? This looks like mostly non-prescribed.
13,000 are from prescription opioids.
Yeah, has that changed?
It's gone up a little bit, but it's not really clear if... it's not really clear how much of that's gone up. They didn't report that data out separately. So there's a lot of resources available for us regarding opioid prescription. The North Carolina Medical Board has a whole section on opioid prescribing under the professional resources link. You don't really have to log in to see that. They have a statement that the medical board believes that fundamental component of medical practice includes the appropriate evaluation and management of pain, and that responsibly prescribed opioid medications may help North Carolina licensees treat their patients with pain safely and improve their quality of life. The North Carolina Medical Board previously had a statement regarding how opioids should be used with guidelines regarding doses. And last year, the year before, they decided that they didn't need to repeat the work that other places have done. And now they endorse the 2022 CDC guidelines for opioid management, which we'll hit the highlights on. The North Carolina Medical Board prescribing policies require an appropriate documentation of history and examination with a diagnosis and a treatment plan when you're prescribing opioids, meaning you've got to have a specific goal and you've got to have a pain-related diagnosis. There are some exceptions for a single prescription when you're on call covering for a group or a practice. And there's exceptions for treating specific diseases regarding this. I apologize, I'm not sure why we're getting this add text click thing in here. A fundamental part of medical practice is the appropriate evaluation of pain. This is why we have pain vital signs present when we do our vital signs. It's considered a critical part of practice. The North Carolina Medical Board requires for all licensed physicians at least 60 hours of category one CME it's actually every 3 years, I think. And starting July 1st, 2017, requires at least 3 hours of CME on controlled substance or opioids as part of your 60-hour requirement. Similar requirements exist for physician assistants, and there are separate requirements regarding prescribing opioids and pharmacology for nurse practitioners. For people that have trouble getting the required amount of CME for opioid and controlled substances, the North Carolina Medical Board actually has a collection of CME courses that are available online. And about half of those are free that you can just log on to and do a CME. I've done this in the past. Most of these courses take less than an hour to go through and will get you your CME fairly quickly. So if it's the day before your birthday and you need a couple extra CME credits, you can get them this way. Although I should mention, if you come to even half of the neurology grand rounds, your CME credits as a licensed practitioner will exceed what the North Carolina Medical Board requires. In 2017, the North Carolina Medical Board passed the STOP Act that was intended to limit the opioid prescriptions, improve patient care, and decrease diversion. And this applies to all Schedule II and III opioids. Part of this was that any APPs had to consult with their supervising physician anytime they were writing a prescription for opioids, especially if it was going to be for more than a 30-day supply. They were required to review the case plan with a physician every 90 days. In the North Carolina law regarding this, the word consult and review are not defined. So it's a little vague when it comes to that, but it does require more supervision. This went into effect in September of 1st, 2017. It also allowed possession and distribution of naloxone without a prescription. So patients can go into a pharmacy here in Durham. The one that often provides this is Gurley's Pharmacy. They can just go in and ask for naloxone and they'll give that to them. It also required timely reporting of all opioid prescription fills to the North Carolina Controlled Substance Database by pharmacies. Starting January 1st of 2018, this law also limited the prescriptions for acute pain to 5 days or 7 days if they were postoperative. So this means that if we're starting a patient on an opioid for the first time ever, we can only give them 5 days of therapy, and then we have to have some sort of reevaluation before we prescribe more. The reevaluation that is required is not defined in the law. That can be a phone call, it could be a video visit, it could be an exchange of emails to make sure that the patient is tolerating the medication, not having side effects, and having the expected response to treatment. As of January 20th, physicians are required to submit all controlled substance opioid prescriptions electronically to the pharmacy. There are only exceptions for temporary technical problems, and you have to document this. In the medical record with Epic, this has been rolled into our prescription. If you write a prescription for an opioid, when you look at the way in which you could submit it between electronic, fax, and print, if you select print, you have to enter a reason why you're printing that prescription out in the record. There are exceptions for federal pharmacies like at the VA. And at the time this law was passed, the VA pharmacies were not accepting electronic prescriptions. And that's changed sometime in the last year or so. So even with the VA, many times you can submit these prescriptions electronically.
As you go on, is what you say applicable to all controlled substances or just opioids?
This is just opioids. So when you're doing controlled anti-epileptics, lacosamide, levetiracetam, Onfi, benzodiazepines, furanol, the one with aspirin in it, if you write that, you'll get the controlled substance approvals prescription window box come up in Epic, but this rule about printing and all of that doesn't apply. They do report all controlled substances to the North Carolina Controlled Substance Database. So even if you're just writing, you know, a UNFI or something like that, if you look in the NCPNP, you will see all of their fills for controlled substances. My only complaint about the NCPNP is they record betalbital plus aspirin because it's controlled, but they don't, they're not required to report betalbital without aspirin. So Fiorcet's not tracked, which becomes a problem for some of our patients. It's required for the way the law is written is it's specifically opioid CME. So the other part of this law that went to effect 3 or 4 years ago is that we are required to rule review the NCPNP every single time we write for an opioid prescription. This has also now been rolled into Epic fairly seamlessly. If you try to write an opioid and you haven't reviewed the NCPNP, you'll get a box come up saying you need to review this with a clickable link. It works great during a patient visit, but if you're doing a refill outside of a patient visit, you have to click on the NCPNP link that's at the top of your inbox screen when you're looking at medication refills. It doesn't automatically link you like it should. This is tracked in Epic, so we have a pretty seamless tracking of this that meets the North Carolina laws regarding that. Some of our providers, especially in the pain clinic, actually do a screenshot or take a snip of the report from the NCPNP and insert it directly into the medical record as part of their documentation. The second part of this was the Safe Opioid Prescribing Initiative, and this has not gotten as much press. This initiative reviews the top 2% of providers prescribing opioids, and they're looking at the top 2% of providers who prescribe prescriptions equivalent to 100 milligrams of morphine a day. And they also review the top 2% of providers by a volume of prescriptions, not just dose of opioids. And any provider that has two or more patient deaths in the previous year due to opioid overdose or poisoning who prescribed more than 30 tablets of opioids gets reviewed by the North Carolina Medical Board. Now, when they first initiated this, they actually put out a report of their very first review, and they reviewed somewhere around 150 records, and 11% of those needed some kind of a letter, and only two physicians got some sort of disciplinary action from that. This data now is not reported separately. So for our licensed physicians here, if you get the North Carolina quarterly report emailed to you, there's a link in there to the board actions, which is basically the bad boys list or bad girls list of who's gotten in trouble. And it's pretty uncommon to see an opioid-related issue on that. Now, it only happens 3 or 4 times a year. Even the ones that have involved opioids, the majority of the ones that I've seen in this report have been physicians that were prescribing for family members or were involved in some inappropriate relationship with a patient that also involved prescribing them opioids. So they were in trouble for the inappropriate relationship part, not so much the opioid part. So some clinical issues regarding this. First of all, it's important to know your North Carolina, your state medical board guidelines if you're moving to another state. You really need to do an appropriate exam. You need to document a diagnosis. You need to justify the pain treatment with something like patients failed alternative medications. And you really need to have some sort of a treatment plan or a stepped approach with this. So in the pain clinic, it's often starting with non-steroidals using adjunctive medications like tricyclic antidepressants or anticonvulsants with a track record of improving pain and or one of the SSRI and norepinephrine reuptake inhibitors like duloxetine or venlafaxine. And opioids are really the last step. What's also really important that's been neglected in the past is you really need to have a plan with the patient. You can't just say, here, take this, you'll feel better. Having a plan where you're going to say, look, we expect you to have some improvement in your activities of daily living. We expect you to be able to walk more. We expect you to do more of the activities around the house that you're unable to do now. It's really helpful to document what they can't do now so that you can document what they're able to do. And then you need to continue treatment based on that response. If you put your patient on pain medications and they're still sitting around not doing anything, that's really a treatment failure. They may feel better, but unless their pain numbers come down and their activity increases, they're not having the expected response. Duke University, as well as national organizations, recommend regular urine testing for patients on opioid therapy. It's actually part of the Duke policy that they need to have a urine drug screen every year, as well as documentation of that you've reviewed the North Carolina controlled substance database, and you need to have some sort of specific treatment agreement for long-term opioid therapy. Urine drug screens are critically important. We have seen patients that persistently test negative that aren't actually taking their medication. I had one patient last year that we discovered was never taking their medications. They were just putting them in the closet, and they had an entire year's worth of opioids stacked up in the closet for no clear reason. So let's briefly talk about the opioids and kind of where they come from and how they might be helpful.
So what if something else pops up in your experience? Does that make me stop the opioid?
Oh, yeah, yes, exactly. I mean, if patients test positive for illicit substances, we stop prescribing opioids. Illicit substances in North Carolina includes THC and other marijuana-derived products. CBD is not tested for. Other states have other rules. Virginia is one of the closest states to us that has a medical marijuana law. I have a single patient from Virginia on long-term opioid therapy who also uses medical marijuana, and he's provided me with his state certificate of being registered for medical marijuana. They have to have that in Virginia in order to have marijuana. Otherwise, they get arrested for illegal possession of marijuana. That's a problem. It's really uncommon to have people test up for other things, other than marijuana. We've had occasional patients a long time ago that test positive for other opioids that can't be derived from what they're prescribed. For example, if we're prescribing methadone and they test positive for an oxycodone metabolite, well, the metabolism of methadone never turns the product into oxycodone metabolites. That's not possible. So that means they're trading their drug or taking extra from somewhere else. So if you type in urine drug screen, one of the options you get is the one with opioid enumeration. That's the equivalent of the older Mayo Clinic send out one. And that does all the metabolites of the opioids, as well as most of the metabolites of the benzodiazepines with specific levels in their urine. It also does the cocaine metabolites, which the ER test doesn't always pick up. So you get a pretty comprehensive test with that. It includes, I believe it includes fentanyl. I know it includes buprenorphine and butorphanol because I have patients on those products that I've seen that reported out. So all of there's two classes of opioids. There's completely synthetic opioids and semi-synthetic or natural opioids. Those are derived from the opium poppy. These opioids bind to three endogenous opioid receptors. We also have endogenous opioid-like chemicals that are normally functioning in our pain control systems. In the opioid receptors, the mu opioid receptor is responsible for most of the analgesia and most of the side effects. The M2 receptor is really responsible for the respiratory depression, the itching that we see. It does cause prolactin release. We occasionally see people with elevated prolactins caused by an opioid. And the mu opioid receptor is what produces most of the dependence and withdrawal reactions. The kappa receptor is really found in the limbic system and the spinal cord. It does do some of the analgesia, But it also does the altered mood and respiratory receptors, respiratory suppression. The delta opioid receptors are mainly in the brain. We don't entirely understand what they do. And then methadone in particular can activate the NMDA receptors, which in some patients can be helpful from a pain modulation standpoint. There are receptors systemically in the GI system that cause the constipation that we see. Now, in terms of opioid receptors, we have the straight out agonists that we're mostly familiar with, but we also now have partial agonists and partial antagonists. Naloxone and naltrexone are pure antagonists. They block the activation of the receptor. They fully reverse the effects of the opioids. If you have a patient that's on opioids and they take low-dose naltrexone, which is one of these kind of less commonly used pain things, it throws them immediately into withdrawal and they're really unhappy about it. The other thing that's important is that buprenorphine, which is the Butrans patch, there's a film that dissolves in the mouth, is a partial agonist, but it also binds the receptor very, very strongly and blocks the receptor activation by other opioids. That's why it's being used for treating opioid dependence disorders or addiction. And they recently, the DEA actually changed the rules so that any physician can prescribe this to treat opioid dependence. It used to be restricted to people licensed for that. But what that means is if you give them, if a patient takes a low dose of buprenorphine and they're using a high dose of an opioid, they could in fact have withdrawal, because the receptor is now being blocked so strongly, their other opioid can't get in there and they can have withdrawal symptoms. Butorphanol, which is Stadol nose spray, has been on the market since the mid-1990s, is both a partial agonist and a partial antagonist. And it can also trigger withdrawal as a side effect. It's a very quick acting pain medication. It's squirted up the nose. It's been used back in the past for things like cluster headaches and migraine. And it's really pretty addictive. I've seen a number of patients that have problems with it. But the other difficulty, and we've seen this a number of times from patients coming from an outside place, is their doctor will have put them on like oxycodone three times a day for their cluster headaches and given them Stadol. And then they're not really having great pain relief because they're having a combination of withdrawal and other symptoms from using both of these together. Tramadol is an interesting synthetic opioid agonist that also has a pretty strong serotonin reuptake inhibitor. And that's important to remember. The only time that I've seen actual serotonin syndrome was a patient who was on three different antidepressants and an opioid like tramadol that was an SSRI inhibitor, reuptake inhibitor. And one of her doctors bumped up her antidepressant dose. She wasn't taking triptans at all, by the way, and she had actual serotonin syndrome because of all the different serotonin blockers she was on. So in the opioid receptor, there's actually a genetic single nucleotide variation that results in altered binding. And there are some patients who genetically have a suboptimal response to opioids because of this. Opioid metabolism is really complex. I'm not going to go through it. This is just an example of morphine's metabolism. And all of these single direction arrows are actually reversible, with the exception of maybe codeine to morphine. But it's really complicated. There's a lot of different products generated. And if you see a patient with a UDS that's got something weird on it, it's sometimes helpful to review the metabolism and make sure that that product can actually be generated through the metabolic pathway. Opioid metabolism, for the most part, depends on the 2D6 and the 3A4 system. 2D6 mainly metabolizes codeine, hydrocodone, tramadol, and a little bit of oxycodone. The 3A4 does these other metabolites. You'll notice that morphine isn't on this list. It's mostly metabolized by hepatic glucuronidation. And so some of these enzyme systems don't necessarily affect that. If you're on a strong 2D6 inhibitor, codeine doesn't work. Codeine is mostly a prodrug. It's not really analgesic by itself. It has to be metabolized to morphine to provide that benefit. And so when you look at a UDS on a patient that's taking codeine, they're mostly going to test positive for morphine. There are people who genetically have a very low activity of 2D6. These patients don't metabolize most of the opioids very well. They also don't metabolize some of the antidepressants. This is why psychiatrists now are doing genetic analysis of patients' hepatic enzyme systems to figure out whether or not their antidepressant isn't working because of their genetics or because of their severe depression. These patients, if they're a low metabolizer, will have high levels of opioids, and they don't respond to codeine or tamoxifen because these drugs aren't converted to the actual effective thing. And they typically have really poor relief of their pain with codeine just because it's not metabolized. There's intermediate and normal 2D6 metabolizers. If you see one of these reports, that's how they often report it out. And then there's ultra rapid 2D6 metabolizers. It's about 1-2% of Caucasians and about 30% of patients that trace their genetic ancestry to the North Africa region. These patients have very little benefit from opioids metabolized by 2D6 because they have such a high first pass metabolism that just none of it gets out. In patients that are given codeine that are ultra rapid metabolizers, so much of the codeine gets metabolized to morphine so quickly that they actually have very high levels of morphine in their blood, much higher than you might expect. The 3A4 variability genetically is not that high, but there are multiple 3A4 inhibitors. Many of the oral antifungal agents like ketoconazole inhibit 3A4. Verapamil is a mild to moderate 3A4 inhibitor, one of the more common things that we may be using. Two of our newer headache medications, Ubrelvy and Nurtec, are also metabolized by 3A4. And at least one of the newer antibacterial drugs, just saw a patient yesterday and learned this, there's a new drug for bacterial overgrowth called Xenam that's a strong 3A4 inducer. And so people on 3A4 inducers are then going to have poor response to drugs that metabolize with this. So it's important to keep in mind the metabolism of some of our drugs. So I thought I would run through a few of the opioids that are commonly used briefly. Morphine was discovered or synthesized in 1804, primarily metabolized by glucuronidation. A little bit of it's metabolized to hydromorphone at higher doses. Codeine, as we mentioned, is metabolized by 2D6. It's mainly converted to morphine and it's very rapidly excreted. So it's got a very short duration of action. If you're having someone take codeine every 8 hours, they're going to get pain relief for about 3 hours and then the pain's going to be back for about 5 hours before they get to take anything. And it's really not a great choice for long-term management. Hydrocodone is a lot more bioavailable than codeine. It's mostly converted to hydromorphone, and it's a stronger binding to the mu receptor than codeine, so may provide a little better analgesia. It's also pretty short acting. Most of its analgesic effect is gone after about 4 hours or so. So again, if you give it three times a day, they're not gonna have great pain relief. Oxycodone was synthesized around 1916. It's metabolized by hepatic conjugation and by 2D6 to oxymorphone. Both oxycodone and oxymorphone are analgesic, and it's, like I said, mostly cleared by 2D6. Oxymorphone is interesting. It was synthesized in 1914 before they actually understood the metabolism of opioids very well. It's 10 times more potent than morphine. It's been used in Europe for a lot longer than the US. It was first patented in the US in 1955, but it didn't really come on the market for clinical use until the late 1990s. And there wasn't available in both a long-acting and a short-acting form. And the short-acting form was taken off the market by the FDA because the company that made it was not able to find a way to prevent it from being crushed and abused. And it was, up until it was taken off the market, was one of the most popular prescription drugs that was abused by drug addicts because it gave them a really a good high, apparently. Oh, I'm blocking on it now. It's not available as brand name either in the long acting form. It's all short acting. Hydromorphone, which is Dilaudid, has been around since the 1920s. It's also stronger than morphine. 62% of oral hydromorphone is metabolized away on the first pass by the liver. It tends to make people pretty euphoric. It's really popular in the ER for patients with headaches. There's this whole group of people that just love Demerol for their headaches. But in randomized trials, Compazine and Benadryl are better than Dilaudid for pain relief in these patients. Methadone was actually synthesized in the early 1900s in Europe and was primarily made by the Germans during World War II when they weren't able to get the precursors for morphine. We actually got it in 1947. It was part of the reparations. We basically stole it from Germany, just like aspirin, which we got from Bayer Pharmaceutical at the end of World War II as part of the settlement. It's mostly conjugated and excreted in the feces. It's very bioavailable. It is a mix of R and S forms, and the S form actually binds the NMDA receptor, which may be part of its activity. It also inhibits serotonin and norepinephrine uptake. And the biggest problem with methadone is that the analgesic effect is only about 8 hours after a dose, but the elimination half-life of this medication is up to 150 hours. And so when you put patients on methadone, their blood levels gradually build up for a week, and patients can become profoundly sedated or have respiratory suppression 7 to 10 days after they start on it. So it's a little difficult to use clinically. Fentanyl was actually synthesized in 1959, primarily as an adjunct for general anesthesia. And the transdermal patch came on the market in the 1990s. The problem with fentanyl, I think we're all familiar with the synthetic versions of this that are killing people that use IV drugs. And it's significantly more potent than morphine. The transdermal patch is delivering something in the range of 25 to 100 micrograms per hour, which is kind of normal dosing is in micrograms. Meperidine is really not very effective. It's only a tenth as effective as morphine. The metabolic metabolite of meperidine is neurotoxic, and if you give it to people too often, they end up having seizures. Propoxyphene is now off the market. It's been off the market for 13 years. This was Darvocet. It was really a crummy analgesic. It's not clear to me how it got on the market. There was a randomized trial back in the early 2000s showing that it was no better than acetaminophen for pain relief. And the biggest problem with propoxyphene is that the metabolite was cardiotoxic, caused arrhythmias, and had a very long half-life. And there are a number of case reports of patients having heart attacks or cardiac arrests from prolonged use of propoxyphene, especially if they had even a single drink of alcohol. Tramadol has actually been around since 1962, but it didn't come on the US market until the mid-1990s. It's actually a Schedule 4 controlled substance. It's not something that we've seen much in the way of abuse. It's pretty bioavailable, and in the primary care practices, it seems to be the preferred opioid just because of the ease of use, the ability to write for refills, and the fact that it's not something that is commonly abused. So from the standpoint of effectiveness, we don't have great studies on long-term use of opioids. Almost all of the studies that led to FDA approval of the long-acting opioids, like extended-release oxycodone or prolonged-release morphine, were 12 weeks studies. A few of them were less than 9 weeks. The short-term studies show clear improvement in pain, but they don't have really good long-term studies of effectiveness. Over 10 years ago, there was a number of studies that showed that patients frequently don't really stick with the opioids. In this study from 2010, only a third of patients that were on opioids for non-cancer pain didn't continue with the opioids. Also around the same time, they looked at people with low back pain, and people giving opioids for low back pain for more than 7 days after a work-related injury were significantly less likely to return to work and much more likely to claim long-term disability. And then also, you know, a little over 10 years ago, in terms of quality of life reports, the opioid therapies didn't even reach quality of life metrics that they were doing in the study. It's not entirely clear why all this is. You know, when they look at patients given opioids, they often have about a 30% decrease in pain when they're first prescribed the opioids, but less than half the patients in this particular study stayed with the medication 7 months to 2 years out. And at least 80% of the patients that stuck with the opioids had at least one adverse event. There's a number of problems with this. First of all, when we look back historically, especially for non-cancer pain like back pain, up until the mid-1990s when OxyContin got FDA approved, there were a number of work-hardening physical therapy residential programs for people with chronic low back pain that didn't have any need for surgery, where they would spend 10 days to even a month doing fairly aggressive physical therapy and behavioral therapy with patients with low back pain to get them back to tolerating all their usual activities and work. And as soon as these extended release opioids came on the market and the short-term studies showed effectiveness and the marketing ramped up from the pharmaceutical companies, insurance companies stopped paying for these really expensive work hardening programs, and they all folded up and stopped functioning. So it's taken a while to kind of get back to understanding that the opioids aren't really a solution to this. Cochrane Reviews in 2007 only found 4 trials that looked at function of patients. Of those 4 trials, 3 showed that tramadol was better than placebo, and 1 showed that an opioid was better than naproxen. And none of these patient studies resulted in improvement in function. Opioids have a lot of side effects. I think we're familiar with most of those. Uncommon side effects from opioids include headache, urinary retention, orthostatic hypotension, myoclonus, and the important one is paroxysmal hyperalgesia. In animal studies, there's actually an increased hyperalgesia mediated at the spinal cord level with long-term opioid use. And we often see this in patients given opioids for, say, low back pain. They complain of really more severe than expected pain in their joints or their muscles or their skin and other areas after they've been on them for a while. And this is in someone who's already on opioids, and going up on the opioids typically doesn't work for that. This is part of the reason why opioids aren't recommended for fibromyalgia, for example. The other reason is that there was a randomized trial about 10 years ago showing that fibromyalgia patients didn't have a good response to opioid long-term. Other uncommon side effects with opioids are increased release of growth hormone, elevated prolactin levels, and what's clinically important is suppressed testosterone levels. I have a number of patients that have been on opioids for many years that actually have significantly suppressed testosterone levels and are on testosterone supplementation. This suppressed testosterone is also likely why men on opioids have erectile dysfunction. Opioids may also contribute to elevated glucose levels and decreased insulin secretion. So they have a lot of significant side effects. In patients with chronic pain, if you're considering opioids, first of all, for most neurologists, you may want to consider referring them to the pain clinic. They actually have a pretty complete evaluation they do on their first visit. They don't prescribe opioids on the first visit. That includes psychological evaluation and a review of their medical history. Within Epic, there is an opioid risk tool that you can use that is a short 5 or 6 question tool that will help you understand what the patient's risks for misuse or addiction are. And if you're starting a new patient on opioids, that's probably worth considering. The other really important point is that most of what we've been discussing is non-cancer pain. In patients that have cancer, it's really pretty different. You still need to follow the rules in terms of prescribing according to the state law, checking the controlled substance database, doing a UDS to comply with Duke requirements, but all of the dose things that are talked about with non-cancer pain don't apply. I only have a couple of patients with tumors that are causing their pain, and they're on doses of opioids that most of us would consider fairly high, but they have a pretty legitimate reason for their pain. And I think I'll stop here a couple minutes early and answer any questions. Yes, Mark.
So I've had a few patients that I've prescribed with this because I have an internet solution for multiple sclerosis. They usually, I think it's a 50 milligram tablet.
Well, low-dose naltrexone really works best if it's between 4 and 10 milligrams a day. And
can you repeat the question?
Oh, sure. The question was about low-dose naltrexone and how it's supplied as a 50 milligram pill, which Mark was asking about.
I've always figured that was probably sort of homeopathic, but don't actually know the dose response curve for naltrexone. Does 2.5 to 3 milligrams a day do much of anything?
So the question is about dosing for low-dose naltrexone. In the fibromyalgia literature, there are there's at least 1 or 2 studies that support the use of 3 to 5 milligrams of naltrexone a day for their fibromyalgia pain. And we use it as an adjunct in some of our patients with face pain, either trigeminal neuralgia or atypical face pain. And in some patients, that low dose is extremely effective. I don't know about its actual treating of multiple sclerosis, but you know, there is some literature suggesting that a high percentage of MS patients have central pain syndrome. So it certainly could be effective for that. And then there's a question from Nada online. Inpatient doesn't count, essentially. The inpatient prescribing of opioids is not what they're talking about in the North Carolina law regarding prescription opioids. That's outpatient only. And the inpatient service, it's really expected that you're treating whatever needs to be treated acutely with the most appropriate treatment.
But you still have to have the accreditation to do it?
Well, the DHE licensing for inpatient prescription of opioids falls on the hospital, not the prescribing physician, is my understanding. Andrew Spector asks about enhanced nursing infrastructure to support opioid prescribing. The thing that Dr. Spector is asking about is a survey program or quality improvement program that they were doing to look at compliance within an individual clinic or service regarding the prescription of opioids and compliance with the Duke requirements for annual UDS and annual prescribing agreement set up. I'm not aware that that's a ongoing nursing effort. I do know that when I get a prescription refill for an opioid, Epic automatically tees up whether or not they're compliant with the Duke requirements. So you can see at a quick glance if they're compliant and then plan accordingly.
This might be more of a lab research question. Do you know if there are any efforts to target the new receptor based on the fact that one causes respiratory depression? Or what do you think are some of the effects that were made that were more safe or effective?
So the question was about research efforts to target the mu1 versus mu2. I'm not aware of any. I know one pharmaceutical company medical director that I talked to 4 years ago that worked for Eli Lilly deliberately tanked their opioid research arm because of the opioid epidemic. They said, we don't need to be in this business because they had an ongoing project. They were trying to create some new long-acting opioid, and they decided not to pursue that because of the ongoing epidemic.
So Tim, I have a question. So when I'm in resident clinic, it seems to be fibromyalgia center. And I often mention to them Wolfgang's old cocktail of low-dose naltrexone and Vimpat. And I get a grand total of no buy-in. Do you want to make a comment on that?
So I don't know about the combination, but low-dose naltrexone is certainly a reasonable thing to try for neuropathic pain or fibromyalgia. And there is literature to support the fibromyalgia side. Vimpat, lacosamide, was really difficult to prescribe for neuropathic pain up until just a couple years ago when it went generic, and now it's pretty affordable. I think it's probably better for neuropathic pain than levetiracetam, and I don't really have enough experience to know if it's as good as gabapentin at this point.
And the problem with naltrexone is they have to go to a compounding pharmacy, correct?
Correct. We usually send it to a compounding pharmacy. You can write that by searching for compounded medicine in Epic, and it comes up with a generic order set. And you just have to type in what you want in the box at the bottom. And we usually compound it as between 3 and 5 milligrams. Last time I talked to a patient, it was around $50 or $60 for a month. So it's not affordable for some of our patients.
Any other questions? Thank you, Tim. That was an amazing review and great talk, and thank you for doing this.
Thanks.